I am Rahul Kashyap, and I am the Android Study Jam facilitator. And today we will be building Mars Real Estate app. Now, what is Mars? And I'll be assisted by Anish, and we both will be guiding you to build an application, that is the Mars Real Estate application. Now, what's a Mars Real Estate application? I'll show you first of all what this application is. So let me first check. Yeah. This is the application. The first page or the main screen of the application shows the different properties which are available for sale or for rent on Mars. And you see there is a list, entire list, which is actually containing 830 plus items. So every time you scroll, you'll get some of the other properties. And this dollar sign means that this property is for sale. And those properties which are without the dollar sign, that means they are just for rent. So when you click any property, it says it's for sale and it will be costed you this much dollars. Okay. And similarly, if you open the another item which does not have a dollar sign, it says that it's for rent and you'll be costed this much per month for the rent of this particular area. So this is the application that we'll be building. And we also have this options menu where we can select whether to show only the properties which are available for rent or the properties which are available for buying, or to show all. Like if I click the buy button, it will show me the properties which are available for buying. Okay. And if I click on rent, it will show the properties which are available for rent. So this is the application, and let's get started with it. So to start an Android application or an Android project, you have to create an application or a project under Android Studio. So we'll start with Android Studio. It takes a bit of time to launch the application. Once you are on the greeting screen of the Android Studio, you can select to create a new project. I'll create a new project. I'll select the empty activity as the main activity. Next. And we can give a name to our application, that is Mars Real Estate, or we can give spaces as well. So this is the name of the application. This is the package name. This is the save location. It will be saved on my desktop right here. And we will be going forward with the Kotlin language and selecting the minimum SDK as API 19. So API 19 means KitKat, and this shows how much devices all over the world can run our application if we keep our APIs 4.4. Then it says 98.1% of the devices of all the Android devices can run this application if we keep the minimum SDK requirement as Android 4.4. Now let's start with the application. So once you click finish, some boilerplate code launches. Now what are the boilerplate codes? What boilerplate codes are the codes which is required for every application, and the Android team makes it available for you so that you don't have to write every application from scratch. More details on the basics of Android application development has been given in one of our videos, and we have uploaded it on YouTube. So please check it out. Our YouTube channel means visit our YouTube channel and watch all our videos. The video which I'm talking about is the tip calculator application. So watch that video. All right. Now our project is ready. So let's get this, let's wait until this things get done. Yeah, now it's finished. Okay, so first of all, what we need to do to start an application is to have the resources that we require. So here we saw in the application that there was a dollar sign. There's a dollar sign, and there's a app icon, you know, this app icon. And right now the internet is working pretty fine, but if it doesn't work pretty fine, then there must be some of the other image visible. So in that case, there is also an image which must be visible, which would say that there is some error in fetching these, photos. So we have to get that resources in our application first of all. So I've kept it in a separate place. I'll just bring it inside my drawable folder. Why under drawable folder? Because all the resources that we require or all the assets that we require is under the drawable folder. By default, there are two items under the drawable folder. One is IC launcher background and other one is foreground. So what are these? These are the icons. And by default, you are given an icon whose foreground is this and background is this green screen. Okay, so let's fetch all the drawables. So what I'll do is I'll open it in files. Showing files. Okay. And I'll open my resources folder also. So we'll take this broken image, connection error for sale outline. We'll see all these drawables. What are they? This background, loading animation, and loading IMG XML. Right. Okay, why not this one? Because the drawable folder doesn't contain the foreground XML file. We'll keep it in a separate folder. We'll copy it. So we'll open. Yeah, so we'll paste it here and we'll replace the original IC launcher background with the one we copied it. Okay, so this is done. And I said I'll be copying the Android IC launcher foreground.xml in a different folder. And that folder is actually drawable version 24. That's visible under the project view. Open the project view. Open app. Then under SRC, main, res, you have the drawable version 24. Now you have this Android IC launcher foreground.xml. We'll replace it with what we have copied. Open in file, show in files, and replaced. So I guess, yeah, so now this is the foreground. And if you see, then we have the background as this. So our app icon is now updated. Also the drawable images that we have brought. So broken image means unable to fetch the image. Might be possible if some connection error happens. So this will be visible when means any kind of error happens. Now connection error means when you don't have internet connection and you want to fetch the services. So that's the connection error. IC for sale, that's the dollar sign for sale, dollar sign available on those properties which are for sale. This is the launcher background. Loading animation is the animation. I'll show you. Just loading IMG. Why isn't it visible? Okay, no problem. Actually, it is a loading indicator which is visible when your internet is slow and it takes a bit of time for the application to load the images. Until then, this loading indicator will be visible. So we have already implemented all the drawable. Next, we shall import all the dependencies that we'll be requiring for the application. So what are the dependencies? And where should we implement all the dependencies? To implement the dependencies, we need to open the build called build.gradle file. And it is more easily visible under the Android view, the build.gradle file. So we'll update on the dependencies that we'll be requiring. So I'll open a different project which contains all the dependencies. Just a second. Is there any problem? Hello, Anish. Kya hua kya? Shit, kab hua ye? Kab hua kabhi, Anish, kab hua ye? Fuck, kitna der se? Sorry. Oh. Hello, am I audible?
Yes, Rahul, audible.
Shit, I didn't realize that I lost it. Means I lost it.
Never mind.
Okay.
Continue.
So where did I leave actually? Did I imported all the drawables?
You were about to import all the drawables.
Okay. So just a second. So I had kept a file on my desktop, a folder on my desktop, which had all the drawables. I'll show it. So this is my resource file where I had kept all the drawables, and I copied it just now. Maybe I got disconnected while copying it. So I'll show that what I did. So this is the application. So this is the drawables folder, and I copied all the images. The first one was a broken image. It means it will be visible when, due to some connection error, the image of the property is not visible. Secondly, we have the connection error. So it will be visible when you have a no connection, when you don't have connection, or you're asking the application to fetch the data, but it's not available due to connection error. Next, we have the for sale icon, which is for, this is visible on the properties which are for sale. The next, we have the background of our app icon. This is the front, the foreground of our app icon. Loading animation and loading image. So this is the loading image. So what is it will be visible when your internet is slow and your application is will be taking some time to fetch all those images. So until that time, this will be visible. So this is what this these are the images drawables that I copied. Next, I have to copy the strings.xml file. So what are the strings.xml file? What is strings.xml file? So so there's a message, I guess. So I read it. I'll be taking all the questions once I'm done with my part, and until then I'll continue. So what is strings.xml file? Strings.xml file contains all the strings that you'll be using. It is helpful for situations where you want your application to support multiple languages. So in that case, you define the thing just over here, and you can give the alternative for different language. Okay, if you want the language to be available in English, Hindi, or any other language, so you have to define just once, and it will appear everywhere on the application. So you'll copy all the strings that will be requiring under this project. So these are the strings. So these are the strings that we'll be using. One is the app name, that is real estate on Mars. Second is show all rent. These are the options that we saw. So these will be used. Next, I'll import all the dependencies that we will be using. So what is a dependency? Everything we can do, everything from scratch, but the community, the Android community, had created a number of things that we can use in our applications to make our work simpler. So we will be needing to display the image. Okay, so our displaying an image on the screen requires the Android to paint it. So we can write the code for how to paint a particular portion of the string, but that has been provided by the Android community under the name Glide. So we will import such dependencies right now. So how can we import that? So this is the build.gridl file. Here all the dependencies that we require for the project is written, and this is the build.gridl file for the app. So all the dependencies that we require for the development of the application is written over here. So I'll copy the build.gradle file from a project that has the entire dependency required for this application. This is the module level. This is the project level build.gtl file. I'll copy it and paste it. So these are the versions of different dependency that we'll be requiring. Okay. And these are the plugins that we'll be requiring. So we mentioned it over here. Also, did I paste it under the app? Okay, sorry. I copied the one for the project. So I'll have to paste it under the project directory. Similarly, the one for app directory, I mean the app level build.gradle, I'll copy the one and I'll paste it under the app level. Okay, this is done. Also, the colors that we use here are, okay, not the colors, but the themes. The themes that we use here depends upon the material component, because secondary variant and color on secondary, all these are material, means material part of the Android. So we need to implement that dependency as well. So you'll open the build.gradle file and you see we don't have that material one implemented. So we'll implement that as well. I kept it to do it right now so that I can show that how a dependency is added. So we'll add the implementation and then we'll add the dependency that we'll be requiring. So it's com.google.android.material, and we'll have to give the version number as well. So 1.2.1 is the latest one. So this is the way we do it. And once you've added all the dependencies, you need to fetch the codes for this dependency. So how can we do that? Sync now does that for us. So as we click the sync now button, all those implementations will be done and our project will be having all these classes that we'll be importing for a different use. So now we have imported all the build.gradle portion. Next, what we can do is that we can start with the development of the application. So our application basically has two screens. One is the overview screen, where on the overview screen we see a grid of properties that are available for sale. And on clicking any of the item over the and on clicking any of the item available on the screen, we can see we get to the details page where we can see the detail about that property. So we have to define two different screens. Now there is the Android Jetpack. What is Android Jetpack? Android Jetpack is a part of the Android architecture. So it made it easy for the developers to add navigations between different screens without the implementation of intents. So we'll be using Android Jetpack to add navigation to our application. So, and what is navigation? Navigation is the flow of our application. Like here, the first screen will be navigated to the second screen on press of this on press of any of the item. So how can we do that is we'll have to create a navigation file. So click on resource manager, select navigation and add a navigation resource file. We'll name the navigation resource file as nav graph. The navigation file under Android consists of three different things. One is navigation graph, second one is navigation host, and third one is navigation controller. Now what is navigation graph? I'll show it just now. Navigation graph is actually a graph which shows how the navigation is going on in our application. So we'll create two different fragments or activity and we will add navigation to them. The first one will be called the overview screen and the second one will be called the detail screen, and we'll add navigation to it. So instead of creating an activity, or means you can either go with activity or a fragment. What is a fragment? First of all, fragment, as by the name, it's a fragment of the application. You can keep the complete activity as one fragment, or you can keep different number of fragments for one activity. An activity is this complete screen that's visible to you on your Android application. So we'll create one fragment. Create new destination. Now what is destination? Destination is the the end where we have to go. We'll see what destination is. So we'll start with fragment blank. Next, we'll call the fragment as overview fragment, because this will be representing the overview screen of our application. So we call it as overview fragment. Finish. And it has this home button. Now this home button suggests that this is the first screen, or this is the screen that will be visible. If we create a number of different fragments, that home screen will stick only to this one. But yeah, we can change according to our requirement. So we'll create one more destination because we'll be needing two different screens. So create a new destination, click on fragment blank and select. This time we'll name it as detail fragment. So this is the detail fragment and this is the overview fragment. Now what we'll do, we'll add navigation. It's very easy, just slide it from here and navigation will be added. Sorry. See. So both of them are connected. Now we have to just tell the tell the application, then on press, that on press of what this navigation should happen. Okay, so what should we press to have this navigation in function? So we'll do it later once our designing of this application and this screen is over. Now let's move forward and add these two fragments as a part of our main activity main.xml. So I said no navigation in Android consists of three different things. One is navigation graph. This is the graph. Next is navigation host. And the third one is the navigation controller. So navigation controller defines or determines how and when the navigation will occur. Navigation host is the one which is monitoring the navigation in the application. So in this case, we'll keep activity main.xml as the navigation host because it is the main activity. And it will have all those features for, you know, navigation. So we'll open activity main.xml. It is under the layout. Activity main.xml. And we'll search for nav host. So we have this nav host fragment. We'll add it. So it will ask us to select the navigation graph. So we have created one navigation graph. So we'll select it. And now we have created a navigation host, that is our activity main.xml. So this is it. Okay. See, we have this fragment which says the navigation graph is the nav graph that we have defined in the navigation folder. And name has been given. These are the default values that are given. If required, we'll change these things. But now we are done with navigation and the nav graph thing. Also, we saw that on the overview screen, we had an options menu, these options menu. So we have to add these options as well. So how do we add options? So to add options, we have to add an option XML file as well. So click on res, click on new, click on Android resource file. And select the resource type as menu. We call it menu under Android, give a file name. So we'll give the file name as overflow menu. Why overflow menu? Because it overflows from the app bar or the action bar. Okay. And we have created one overflow menu.xml. So this is the overflow menu.xml. We will be adding the different options required. So what are the different options? So in our application, there are three different options. One is show all, other one is rent, and third one is buy. So I'll add three different menu options. Just you need to do is to drag. See, one of the items has been added. Drag once more. So two of the items will be added. Drag once more and three of the items will be added. So we have all the three items, but we need to change the name of these items. So we can either do here. So we can give them an ID or under the code view. See, we have this team three different items, which we can give the title as and the read string, because we have the title under the strings.xml file, because we saw it. The first one is show all, the second one is rent, and third one is show by. So will open, sorry. We were in the overflow menu.xml file. So we'll give the title as string slash show all. This is the first item. Second one is show by, and third one is show rent. So these are the three different items that are added under menu. And along with the title, we have to give an ID. So we'll give an ID to it. So Android ID. And we can give any ID, like let's name it as ID show all. Similarly, for show by, and the third one as show rent. So we are done with the options menu as well. So now we have added the options, but we need to add functionality to the options, and we need to bind it with the Kotlin file as well. So which Kotlin files do we have to bind it? So as we created the different fragments, like the fragment detail and fragment overview fragment. Oh, all right. So we can change the name. Will be better in readability. Fragment overview and refactor rename fragment detail. So as we created these fragments, we have three different files over here too. So how do we add it? So we will open the overview fragment, because under the overview fragment only we have the options, and as we click the details fragment, we don't have any options there. See, there's no option. So we'll add the option. I'll add the function to call these options under the overview fragment. So we'll open the overview fragment.kt. This is the overview fragment.kt, and we as we created the fragment detail XML file, the fragment that we created during the nav graph, these files are auto generated. Now, not all of the functions that are overridden will be required, but just this on create view. So we'll remove all those functions that are not required to make our class look simpler. So on create is not required, and this is not required. Companion object is also not required. So we have the onCreate view, and before returning the inflator, we have to set has, or we have to keep the set has options as true, because this screen has an option available. So set has options had been true. Also, along with this change, we have to add two different functions. One will determine what will happen on click of an option. Like when we click an option, what should happen, that will be determined by one of the functions. And the other function, it will be required to create these options. So first of all, we'll create it and we'll write the function to create it. And second, we'll add we'll write the function to have the functionality to do what when a button or when a option is clicked. So it'll override fun, because these functions are available under fragment. So we can override these functions, and the function name is onCreate options menu. So this is the function, and onCreate options menu will just take it off. Sorry. So this is the function onCreate options menu that is used to create the option. And second function is on options item selected. So this is the function which will determine what will happen on a particular or when a particular option is selected. So pretty much the thing is done. We can also inflate this option. So like right now we just created the function, but we need to give it the address of the actual option that we have created, so that the bind, so that this KT file, also this Kotlin file, also knows where the option is. So how can we do that? So we have to actually inflate it. Inflate.inflator. Sorry, see, you see this inflator.inflate. Sorry. So even this this onCreateView inflates the fragment overview that we have created. So when we create this, when we created this fragment overview, it by its own binded this to this, you know, this KT file. So on inflator dot inflate, and we'll give the location, that is r dot menu dot overflow menu. So now we have binded the options menu, and we will change this when we have some data to actually show. So this is also done. Next, we will we'll open this detail fragment.kt file. Also, this file is generated on its own, and we won't be requiring it. But we'll keep the things that we that's required. So and we'll remove the other things that we don't require. So we'll keep the we'll remove this on create. We have this. We'll be requiring on create view, and this companion object is not needed. So this is done. Also, there is a particular way of creating a Kotlin class or a class that we follow camel case letters. So the every for, so the first letter of the class name will be capital, and the second word name will also be capital. So fragment detail fragment, and I'll change it later. So this is the one. Next. Next, what we need to do, we have created the options, we have created the different screens. Yes, so we have this fragment detail.xml. Right now it's empty, and even the fragment overview.xml, this is empty. We will now create the UI of this screen that's required. Means the screens that we have here, this is the overview screen, so we'll create the UI. I have kept the UI already written in a different folder. I'll just copy the codes so that it, you know, it does, it doesn't take a bit longer to develop the UI. So Mars resources app fragment detail and fragment overview. And this is the fragment overview. I'll copy it. Okay, this is the data class that we'll be requiring later, so we'll remove it now. Also, this text is not needed right now, so we can remove it. Fragment detail is also need to be populated, so we'll open that XML file again. This is the one. Map resources, okay. Fragment detail. So this is the screen. We can see the design. So now we see the design that we have on the detail screen is visible. So this is how the detail screen also looks like. We have an image at the top, we have a text, and then we have the amount that is that will be available for rent. So, and also the overview overview screen. Let's see the fragment overview.xml as well. this is the fragment overview.xml. Yeah, so we'll create one more. So what we did with the fragment fragment overview.xml is that what we have used recycler view to show these images. Now, what is a recycler view? Recycler view is a scrollable list, but it's a different from scroll view. Why is it different from scroll view? Because scroll view requires all the items to be known before displaying on the screen. So if you have painted it using the scroll view, then every other item would have been fetched first, and then this scrollable list of items will be visible. But with recycler view, what happens? The things which can appear on the screen is only fetched, and as soon as you move the screen, it will be fetched. So it's actually improves the performance of the application. Therefore, recycler view is more preferable. So you see, when we scroll a bit, long, then we see that it's not fetched yet, and taking time. So this is how the recycler view works. So what we have done in the recycler view to keep the code short and easy for reading is that for every item on the recycler view, this is the item on the recycler view, we have created a grid item XML along with it. That means this has a separate XML file of its own. So we will open that under, we'll actually create that file. So under the layout, we'll create a new XML file. We'll name it as grid view item. This is a item under, this is the item under, overview screen. And I'll copy the code for the item as well, grid view item.xml. We'll remove this data. We'll bring it later on. So it shows an error because we haven't implemented this. Now it's good. So this is the particular you see here. So this is the list item that we see. So every list item has a photo or image of their property and a dollar sign, which depends on whether the property is for sale or for rent. If it's for sale, then the dollar sign will be visible. Otherwise, this dollar sign will not be visible. So we have created the grid view item as well, fragment overview.xml and fragment detail.xml, activity main.xml. Okay, fine. And let's now create separate folders for each of these, each of these KT files, so it will be easier for management. So we'll create new package, and we'll name the package, the first one, as the overview. It will contain all the classes related to the overview screen. New Kotlin class file, and we'll create a package, and we'll name it as detail. Will create all the it will have all the classes for the detail screen, and also we'll create another package named network. Now what network will do, it will fetch all the details and all the images, all the JSON files, and it will be residing under the network folder. So we'll move the overview fragment under the overview folder. Okay, refactor, and detail fragment under the detail folder. Factor. Now overview fragment has some errors. I'll see where the error is. I can't find the error. On create function, this is the function available. Okay, so where is the error? Acha, here, overflow menu. what it says, create a create extension function menu inflate dot inflate. This is how we do for that, for including the binding. So we have to means there are two different ways of linking the Kotlin file with XML. One is using the data binding, and other one is by using the set content, you know, this find view by ID. So find view by ID is pretty outdated. So now we use data binding for binding the application. I mean, Kotlin with XML. This is also explained in the tip calculator application. So what we can do is that we can enable data binding so you see data binding is actually enabled, so that's not a problem now. Overview fragment. Okay, I'll see what past value for the parameter menu. Don't require anything to pass. Acha, I'll see. Next, we need to have view models and live data. So what are view models and live data? So these are just the names. It's not anything fancier. So our application has an overview screen which has a number of functions to implement. So we'll create a view model and we'll see how these functions are implemented. So under the overview screen, we'll create new Kotlin class file and we'll name it as overview view model. Now overview view model will extend the view model class. Now why will it extend the view model class? Because we can do means sometimes it what happens is that, consider this application. So if we don't use view models, if you just go through the way that we know for writing the functions that a particular screen is required to have, like this this screen requires to have the function to fetch first of all of the data, all of the all of the, you know, images or the properties. Also the function should fetch on all only the rent properties if asked only for rent, secondly the buy one, and a number of different functions. So if we use the native way, what happens is that when we just keep this app in background and use some other application, then what happens, the data is lost. And every time you get back to that application, the application has to refresh that data. Even this happens if you turn the phone upside down. So if you turn this phone this way, but since this application has been made with the view model, this is not happening. But if you don't use view models, then the application will be rebuilt and everything will be refreshed. So that's the requirement for view model. And how do we use a view model? So a view model will have the functions that we require. So what are the functions that we require? So first, without for not wasting the time, I'll copy the codes so that won't take much time. So app map resources, this is the overview view model. RCL state. So this is the overview view model. This extends the view model. First of all, we have the API status. We can remove this. We don't need it now. We'll add it later. And even this one. We have the properties. Okay, so what I think I need to do is that I need to copy it from the different code file. open. What happened? Started. Let the project get built. Okay, so this is the overview view model. This is the view model that will be required to have. Mars real estate and paste it. So, so first of all, we'll be having means this overview screen will be receiving a response. No, when we call the API to return the properties, then it will be given to this screen. So right now we consider only the string as a return file. So if the assume that the API file or API returns a string, and we store it under the response. So that's and we actually use a live data instead of the normal data as a string, because this view model works with live data well, and we use mutable live data because every time a new item is fetched, a new string will be given. Like, consider the API returns a list of different strings. So to keep the live data mutable or to able to change, we have to use the mutable live data. And this is just a getter function which returns the response that we have created here. And this is the init function. And init function gets called when this class is called, means whenever this class is called, the first function that runs is this init function. And as soon as this overview model will be called, this get Mars real estate properties function will be called. Now what get Mars real estate properties function do that it gives the response of the value, means it sets the response value as a particular string that we fetch from the API. So but here this API thing will be implementing later, so for now we'll keep this and move forward. So overview view model is done, overview fragment.kt is done. Next, similar kind of thing we have to create under detail directory, and we'll create a Kotlin class, and we'll call that class as detail view model. But here there is a constraint that detail view model will be requiring an input. Why detail view model will be requiring an input? Because detail view model only shows the details of that item which has been clicked. So this screen must have that input that which of the item has been clicked. So in that case, to use view models with an input, we have to use view model factory file. So it's just the name, anything not means complex. So I'll show you how it is implemented. So this is the detail view model, and this is the detail view model factory. So what we do here, first of all, I'll copy the code, and then I'll detail view model, and the new detail, I'll create a new Kotlin class file, detail view model factory. So this is the class. So under the network directory, we have to create a new class, which is actually equivalent to the Mars property class. So Anish will explain what Mars property class will be. For now, I'll just create a Mars property class. So this is the Mars property class. This is done. We have imported it. And the detail view model, you see what we do here is that detail view model factory takes two arguments. One is the Mars property, This mass property is the property that will be given to the, this is the property that will be given to the detail screen. A detail screen will be provided with a property, a particular property. So this property, if for example, is given, then this detail view model factory will be given this property and a context to the application. Which application do we want to, means which application we have to pass. So we are asking this as an input for detail view model factory. This is actually a constructor, and under this we pass this detail that is mass property and application to the detail view model actually. So detail view model takes two arguments, mass property and app, but we can't just simply direct, means we can't just directly give it the details. So in that case, what we need to do is that we need to create a detail view model factory, and we pass that detail view model fact, all those things that we require, to the detail view model. And in this way, this detail view model gets all those the codes. This is it. And I don't think anything more is left. Okay, this is the different project, no? So similarly, detail view model factory, this is the detail view model, and we'll create the detail view model similarly as it was on the different application that I saw, that I showed. So this is the detail view model, and this is the detail view model. We'll import this as well. So detail view model is done. And why it says an error, like parsable. Okay, this is now detail view model factory. Detail view model factory says an error. Okay, all right. So we'll just remove this one. This is also gone. Next, overview fragment. Overview fragment. And see what this overview fragment is actually that creates an error. So overview fragment under the on create. We have to pass a menu. Sorry. Yeah. So this, if you remember, this is the on create options menu function, which was used to create the options that we actually created in the XML file. So we have to pass the location of the XML file that that actually has the menu, along with the menu that it has to associate it with. So the menu that it has to associate it is actually called under the parameter. So this is the menu that we have to pass it. And now it must not have an error. Yeah, so it's fixed. Now overview fragment is defined. Now overview fragment has on create view. This on create view binds this overview fragment.kt file with the one that is an XML with this statement r.layout.fragment_overview. This is the fragment overview. Okay, next there is the overview view model. Overview view model has the response that we get from the API. Right now it must not be that clear, but once we are using the means the APIs itself, then it will be more clear to you. Next, this is the Mars property class. Mars property class will be defined soon by Anish, and you'll know what it is. Next, there is the detail fragment.kt file. This is the detail. This links the one with the detail fragment that we created under the XML, that is fragment underscore detail. And you see here, both of them are binded. Also, fragment detail. Also, we have this detail view model. Now, detail view model is all the functions that we require for the detail view. So every detail view will be requiring a particular Mars property, means a particular property on Mars, so that we can display all the images or the properties that, or the information that is linked to that property, like the image of that property, whether the image available for rent or for sale, and the cost that it means it's requires for you to hire or to buy it, whatever. So this is what it is. Detail view model will be given the Mars property, but we can't just give it directly. So what we do is that we create a detail view model factory over here, and we pass the we ask the parameters that are required, and then we pass it to the detail view model. But since overview model didn't require any input or didn't require any parameter, so we don't need to create the view model factory for overview screen. So this is it for now. And I think Anish, am I leaving anything?
No, it's fine, Rahul. I'll take over from you.
Okay. Also, I'll create this Kotlin class file that is Mars API. Mars API or Mars API service. That's Mars API service. Okay.
Yeah.
So, Mars API service. Now, what we will do is that under this Mars API service.kt file, we will call the JSON file. We'll all have all the requirements or the items that we have to show on the overview screen, and we'll proceed further. So from here, I'll ask Anish to take over and continue. I'll continue back when this API thing is done, and we'll present all the items that are available on the screen. We'll call all those items, we'll fetch all those items, and we'll then show it on the screen, overview screen, as well as on the detail screen. Okay. Anish, should I stop presenting?
Thank you so much, Rahul. I'll be taking over from your own. Mm-hmm. Can you stop presenting the screen?
Sure.
Thank you. All right. So I'll be continuing from the exact point where Rahul left. The file directories and all, everything, the code is exactly same where he left. So for the point which I'll be concerning about is connecting to the web services and then fetching the data from there on, and how to implement that data in an application. Now, before that, where exactly is the data? The data is being hosted in a web server as a REST web service. Well, I won't be getting much into what REST architecture and all these are, because then we'll be going off topic. You can like Google it out. It's very important for you all to understand. So the web services uses the web. Basically, it's been hosted on a web server, and that uses the REST web service. And we will be, you know, connecting with that web service and receiving that data in an application, which we can then fed in the places where it is required. Fine. So the data which is being coming to us comes in form of JSON. It can come in form of XML as well. In our previous videos, I have discussed how data can be transferred online. Like it can be in the form of XML, JSON, or there are some other ways as well. JSON is the most popular structure of transferring data. What exactly is JSON? Well, JSON is an interchangeable format for representing structured data. Fine. So let me show you this. Following the 8th lecture of our Android Coding Fundamentals, that is getting data from the internet. Here, connect to web services, yeah, this one. So we'll be fetching data from this particular. Web service. Let me show you. Yeah, from this particular web service, we'll be fetching the data. And if I add the endpoint to it, so this is the JSON data we'll be getting. It has some more than 830 row, 30 values and all. So first of all, it's not possible for us to understand what is being happening in this data, because it's not so much in a nice structured way for us to understand in a visual for point of view. So in order to do that, there is a very nice online software called Online JSON Viewer. So what we'll be doing is we'll simply copy this entire JSON file and paste it in the text portion. We'll paste it over here, and immediately we'll be getting to view what this data is actually holding. So in the viewer, as we can see.
Hello, sorry to interrupt you, Anish, but did you start recording?
Actually, Swapnil is recording on my behalf.
Oh, all right.
Are you there, Swapnil? I guess that's what your name is. I forgot. Swapnil, are you recording?
All right.
So the entire JSON data comes to us in form of a JSON array. And the JSON array is like an array which holds the entire JSON objects. The entire JSON objects come in form of an array. Let me expand this further. So these are the JSON objects which we are receiving. See, we have got somewhat around 837 data coming to corpus. And each particular JSON object holds a detail about the Mars property it is concerned with. Suppose I'm clicking on this one, 2. So this is so every JSON object will have the similar structure, having the price. So let me tell you, this, the JSON objects usually have a name and key value pair structure. Fine. So we have got price, we have got ID, we have got type, and we have got the image source, that is the link of the image of the Mars properties. Now a question might come to your mind that why JSON data? I mean, why can't we just simply pass plain texts and all? That is possible, we can do, but the point is that is not something in a very structured point of view. I mean, if we receive plain texts and all, then parsing it for the sake of our application will be very difficult, because that is in some form of string or something of that sort. So parsing that becomes very difficult. So we need a structured representation of data, you know, and JSON provides us with that. JSON provides us a structural point of view where the things are to the point, and whatever data we require, we simply navigate that according to this structure we are getting. We can even have nested JSON objects as well. Like, there will be another object inside this particular object. There can be another JSON array inside a particular JSON object. It can get as nested as it requires. Fine. So this is the way we are dealing with. And the point of showing you the JSON arrays, because it's always advisable to, you know, visualize the JSON data which you're working on, because without doing so, right, directly getting on with the application seems very pointless. Because when you know how the structure is, you'll be able to code it accordingly, right? And the most important part is, in order to use this JSON data, we need to have a library. There's an Android library which is known as Retrofit, which is a REST client library, which enables us to connect with these web services and then fetch the data. Fine. So this Retrofit is extremely important for us to work on it. There are other libraries as well, but Retrofit is very common these, and mostly people rely on it. So in order to use Retrofit, as Rahul told you, I'll be again doing the same thing. We need to get the dependencies, right? So I'll be copying the dependencies from here. Like, I need to implement these. Gradle module, this one, and at the very end, simply add the dependencies here. And then I need to sync it. It will take some time, I guess. Fine, the syncing is done. So you can see there are two implementations. The first one is for the Retrofit, the version 2 which we'll be using. And the second one is the converter scalers. That is basically the converter factory, which will actually convert the JSON data which we receive as a string, so that we can receive the data in form of a string. And Retrofit and the converter scalers are what actually work together, which enables us to, which provides us the data in form of a string representation of JSON. Fine. And now let's go back to our application and to Java. In the network package, in my session, I'll be mainly dealing with these two classes, Mars API service.kt and Mars property. So what are these two files? This file will be responsible for holding the APIs and all the networking portions which are required to connect and also to fetch the data. We have the base URL right over here in form of a constant variable called base URL. And here on, we'll be using Retrofit to connect with our web service and also to fetch the data. Everything will be done in this particular file. So before doing that, let's create an object for Retrofit. Okay, I forgot to add one thing. Retrofit uses Java version 8 dependencies and all. So it depends on the Java 8 language features. So make sure to add these lines. Okay, these are very important. Let me copy these, and we need to paste it in the very gradle.build file only. Build.gradle file only. Right about here. Below build features, here it goes. So I've added the versions and all the things which are required, and I'm syncing it up. Fine. So we are done with the syncing and adding dependencies part. Coming up next, we need to basically create an object of the retrofit builder. First of all, let me copy the code and I'll explain what is being taking place. Just a minute. Below. Just a minute. So basically, one more thing, I need to import these. We can simply import them by clicking Alt and Enter together if you're using Windows. Right. So what is actually happening here? Basically, while creating or while building a retrofit object, it requires two things primarily. First of all, the base URL, the URL which we'll be working on, that is this particular URL for the web service, right? So we have mentioned that in the base URL portion, and then we need to have the converter factory, like the way we want to convert it. We basically are using the scalar converter factory as we have mentioned previously. So the very purpose of it is, together with the retrofit, it will convert the JSON data which we are receiving from the API, and it will then convert that data to JSON string so that we can, you know, visualize the entire data we are receiving in form of a string. That is it. That is the very fun. And if we do that, then after, I mean, writing all these, retrofit object gets created. Fine. And then retrofit basically asks us for an interface. That is, an interface is needed to be created to create a structure for each of our services. I mean, when we are calling any particular web service, it has got a base URL. Then it requires certain methods, like the kind of method we want, like the kind of method we want to perform. Okay, and also it also has some extra IDs and all, which are important. So the method and all, everything gets documented in the interface. So this interface and structurization of this interface is very important while using retrofit. So coming down here, we'll be creating this interface called Mars API service, which will pass in the getter decorator the real estate, which is basically the endpoint. I mean, basically, if you see this is the endpoint. We want to reach to this particular point of our web service. So if we surf it up in the internet, we can see that the JSON getter, we get to receive the JSON object, JSON data. So this is where we need to reach. So that is why we pass. Let me copy the code. So that is why we pass it inside here, and then we receive a call string which initiates the entire calling of the API. Just a minute. Yeah. Okay. So that I need to import. Done. After which, I need to create an. Basically, what is happening over here is the main Mars API service interface defines a public object called Mars API, which is basically used to, you know, initiate the retrofit service. Let me copy this up. This will initiate a retrofit service. We are basically telling the retrofit object that this is the particular Mars API interface we are dealing with. So this interface has got all the details of the kind of information we want to receive from the API. So it has got the endpoint. It has also got, the call will initiate the networking, and then we have the retrofit object, which we have already created over here. And it will also, and the retrofit.create will basically, you know, like inside the create, we basically pass the API, the interface which holds the entire information about it. So this is how we actually get to do it. And one more thing, since this calling is very expensive, so we do it in form of singleton objects so that, you know, like it gets much more cost effective and all. So with that being done, I'll go back to overview, view model. And as Rahul have already mentioned about the response variables, I'll not be getting into details of it. We have got the getMars real estate properties. This particular function is responsible for fetching up the JSON data, and it will store, it will string it, stringify, and then it will return, restore the response into this response variable. Initially, we have only set the Mars API response over here, so we'll be removing this particular line. we don't need it now. We'll be feeding it with the actual data. Let me go back and call the web service in overview view model, right? So just a minute. Yes. So I'll be doing this one. I'll be copying this particular line. What is happening is, okay, let me import these. Something is wrong. Just a minute. Perfect importing. Just a minute, I need to copy it from an existing file then. Have the callback function for that. Okay, let me do this. So, import this manually. So the error gets solved, I suppose. It does, and it will ask me to implement two methods. Implement the methods. I need to implement both of these methods. I'll explain once the code is done what's happening over here. Right. So what is happening is we are calling the Mars API object, and there we are calling the retrofit service, which in turn calls the get properties, which we have already defined the function get properties, right? And it will get the properties, and also and we are doing NQ. Now this will actually start a new thread in the background, because if we cannot, you know, do all the networking stuffs in the main thread, because that will actually throw certain errors. Okay, so the error is network on main thread exception. So we don't want that. So so we do the NQ part, and here we have got two callback function. We have the callback, which in turn calls these two functions, on failure and on response. On response will work when we get the response, and on failure will work when we fail to get the responses, right? So I'm coming back, and I'll simply copy these two lines of code. On failure, coming back to the code, on failure, it will perform this, and on fun, it works out. Then on response, this function will work out. Sorry. So we are getting the error, where, and if we get to encounter any errors, then it will be displayed along with this failure line and all. And if we get the response, then the entire body of it will be stored in response.value, and this response.value will be displayed in, let me show you, in layout fragment overview.xml. It will be displayed over here by view model.response. So if I run the application, okay, we'll be encountering one error as we are doing it. Let me tell you. The error is basically that we did not ask for the permission of the internet. Okay, so we won't have to ask, but the internet permission is very much important. So we need to add the permissions line in the manifest folder, because otherwise it won't be possible for us to run the application. So I'm coming back to android.manifest, android.manifest.xml. Before, right above the application tag, we'll add this line. This line will ensure that the internet connection is being done and it won't ask for any permissions of something of that sort. The application will be able to freely run. We are expecting to receive the JSON data on the screen. Let me see if it's coming. Okay, wait a second. Did I miss out anything? Base URL, the mystery of actual fact. Yeah, we received the data. You can see the entire JSON data. We have received it, but now we cannot simply parse this data because we are receiving data, this data in form of a string. So doing that will be absolutely meaningless. We need to, you know, convert this JSON data to a Kotlin object. And for doing so, we have another, we have got another library called Moshi, which works with Retrofit, and Moshi is responsible for converting the entire JSON data which we receive to an understandable Kotlin object, right? So that is really important for us to parse the JSON data. I'll be copying the dependency of Moshi from here. Coming back to our application in the build.gradle file, I'll go down and copy this line. Alongside that, I need to also copy this particular line, because previously we were working on converter scalers and now we're using Moshi. We won't be using converter scalers for converting or parsing our JSON data. Moshi will be responsible for doing that this time. So we'll be removing this particular line and we'll be adding this one, which will work with Retrofit to convert it to some convert the JSON data to Kotlin objects. So let me delete this line and replace it with the line which I've copied. Let's sync the application. Syncing is done. Coming back, I'll come down, and before that we need to understand the JSON data we are getting. We have already viewed that. Okay, let me show you once again. So every JSON object is having what? Price for the particular piece of land. We have got the ID of that particular land and also the type, whether the user wants to buy it or give it on rent or something of that sort. And also we have got the image, which is holding the image of that particular plot of land in mass. Fine. So every JSON object or every JSON data, for every property, we are having the similar kind of objects. So they have got certain structure. We need to at first create a class where we will be structuring this data so that it can hold when it comes back to us. And this is where, let me clear these few files. And this is where Mars property class will come into play. Like, this class will actually be helpful for us to establish the structure which we are dealing with. Coming back to here, we have this data class. Just a minute. Let me clear the code here. See, this data class will be responsible for giving it the structure, the kind of structure we need to hold the values of. So it has got ID, type, price, and val, IMG, SRC. Now there's one more point which they wanted to tell us. That is, see, ID, type, and price, these are the keys which the JSON data is also having, right? But val, IMG, SRC is not. My point is, if we want to keep any key which is not the keys which are mentioned in the JSON data, like suppose I want to change the ID to something else, like I want to call it identifier or something of that sort. So if we directly do it, that might create some problem for us, because then JSON won't be able to understand what to connect with what, right? So in order to establish that, we add this particular line. And we are still telling that the name IMG SRC, like, do connect that with this particular IMG SRC URL. Now, this is a user-defined ID. I mean, you can now use it because you have already established what it is actually trying to say. What it is actually trying to connect, right? So I'll simply replace this line just to show you that we can also have user custom-defined. I need to import this. Custom defined IDs as well. So this is being done. We have declared the class. Now I need to use Moshi in our services. This will show error because we are not no longer working with Scalar Converter Factory anymore. We'll be working with Moshi now. So coming down, I'll be creating an object of Moshi, fine, because that is important. This will create an object for Moshi right above retrofit. I need to call these. And coming back to our code, I need to update the retrofit. Object creation as well. Now it will be using Moshi Converter Factory. Previously, it was using the Scalar Converter Factory, but we won't be working on it anymore. I'll also remove this particular import statement as well because we don't need it anymore. Fine. Now, we are done with this part. Yes, we need to update the interface as well. Coming back to the code. Interface needs to be updated now, because previously whatever we were receiving back, it was in form of a string. So we directly mentioned the predefined string class which we have in Java. But now since we are dealing with custom defined classes, we want to follow this particular structure, the structure which the JSON data is coming to us in the form. So we need to also mention that particular class as well in this particular line. So I'm simply replacing it up. So it will return me back a list of datas having the type of Mars property class. Fine. So it will be returning to us in that way. Previously it was only string, but now we are dealing with actual data from the JSON object. Fine. So I guess we are done with this part now. Yes. We won't be needing to do any changes in this portion because it is all the very same. So coming back to overview view model dot this part, it will show, it will be showing us error. Let's go back to our code and I'll copy this line. Need to update the callback functions. So it will return in form of this, as we have mentioned. And also, when it comes to our responses, the responses will be coming back to us in this very way. We need to do so. Yep. We need to update the response value to this line. So what is happening is we are receiving the response in form of a list now. So if we do just write dot size to the response dot body, it will simply return me the number of data which we are fetching, which we are getting from the API. So the resultant output on the screen will be success, the number we are getting from the API, Mars properties retrieved. If I run it now, if I run the application now, just a minute. Installed. So see, success, 838 Mars properties retrieved. So we are finally able to retrieve data from our APIs. Now one more thing I'll quickly tell you, since we are using all these callback functions and all these can be replaced with all these can be replaced with coroutines as well. So we have this property in Android. I won't be getting into details about it. I'll simply share these links if you need to know about it. Right over here. And let me continue. Yes. So what I'm gonna do is simply change the get properties function to a suspend function. Coming back to here and suspend get properties. I'll be replacing it with a suspend function. I'll also be providing you links about the suspend function as well. Apart from that, in the view model dot, the resultant function will also change. We'll be having try catch blocks as of now. We won't be having any callback functions because we are simply dealing with coroutines now. So that's one feature which reduces the code and makes it much more efficient for us to use. So if I just simply, copying it up, and I'll replace the entire function with this line, with this one. All import them. That is it. If I rerun it, it will again show me the same output. Okay, so it's missing one. Maybe this will work. This is the application, and it will again be able to retrieve the data. So with that being done, I am done with my portion. Rahul will continue from here on.